Good morning. I would like to call to order the February 7th, 2017 City of Statesboro City Council meeting. We'll begin our meeting today by asking Councilman Phil Boyle to please lead us in an invocation and our pledge of allegiance. Councilman Boyle.
Can you please bow your heads? Dear Lord, so often when we pray, we ask for things, ask for your help, ask for your guidance. But every now and then we should pray prayers of gratitude and thank you for all the things that you've given us. I want to say thank you for the opportunity to serve the city of Statesboro and this wonderful community. Thank you for the amazing growth that you've provided to our town that provides jobs and education for folks not only in Statesboro and Bull County, but for the surrounding area as well. Thank you for my fellow councilman and the mayor. Thank you for the Bull County schools. Thank you for all the leaders in this community that come together to make Statesboro a better place for us and for future generations. Thank you for all that you've given our community, and hopefully be with us as we make decisions for the future of this community. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, a little bit of housekeeping before we get started today. Under recognitions and public presentations, we won't be able to do recognition 3B today. We will have to save that for another day. And also, agenda item 6. Agenda item 10, regarding 2017-06 resolution. Jason Boyles is unable to be with us today, so we're going to postpone that agenda item as well. So now a little bit of housekeeping. So now we're going to go to agenda item 3, which is recognitions and public presentations. Before we do that, I'd like to say that I don't know how many of y'all saw in the newspaper on Sunday, I think it was, where Statesboro have been awarded one of Georgia's three large cities Live, Work, Play Award by Georgia Trend and the Georgia Municipal Association. We won it in conjunction with Roswell and Rome. So we're the only ones south of Macon to take home the bacon. I'm waiting for 2 minutes to say
actually in her notes.
No, it's not. You know, I tend to think in this area of the state we don't get enough recognition. Over the Southwest Georgia get enough recognition, so we'll take it when we get it right. But I do think it was well deserved. I think our community is unique. We said in a rural area, people ask me to describe Statesboro, Georgia, and I say it's a progressive college town that honors its roots of agriculture and hunting. And I think that that pretty much encapsulated it all. So, congratulations to everybody, and special thanks to Robert Cheshire and his staff, who at the time put together, where's Robert? I keep wanting to go here, but I'm not going to do that anymore. Who put together that application in conjunction, I think, Alan Waldron. Help that as well. So before we go any further, just tell us who worked with you on putting that. We need to give thanks to them for getting our city that recognition.
It was Alan Mulgrew, and actually we had an intern from George Southern's MBA program at the time, Sharon Evelyn, who was going on, we hope to be actually the city manager. And she helped put all that together and submitted it, and we're excited to know that learned we were one of them.
Well, I mean, for those of us that were up there, and all council was there, they weren't able to be there at luncheon, but everybody was up there for Mayor's Day. It was a big deal. I mean, it was a real big deal. We got to march on stage with music playing and all good stuff. So, actually, I'm real proud, and thank you. Thank you for doing that.
Actually, Jason Boyle as well, so
that I knew he wouldn't. He'll be as good as anyone. All right, so let's move to recognitions and public presentations. We've got some good stuff today. So let's get started with our presentation of the Arbor Day Proclamation. And if Mr. Siemens will please come forward. And Mr. Parker.
to talk about our Arbor Day and Arbor Day in general, and then the Georgia Forestry Commission will come up and present the city of Statesboro with the Tree City USA Award afterwards. So Arbor Day is set aside for individuals and organizations to celebrate and reflect on the importance of trees. It's the only holiday where we think about the future. The first Arbor Day was started in Spain in 1594 by a mayor. And that mayor planted a poplar tree. And that mayor gave the city a 3-day party and a feast.
Do you have any details on the park?
Very good. The first American Arbor.
Yeah, I did. Don't miss it. A little more information.
Okay. We'll help you on the trees when you're ready.
Okay.
All right, first American Arbor Day was started by J. Sterling Morton in Nebraska in 1872. Nebraska, they planted 1 million trees that year. Okay, the first Georgia Arbor Day is in 1890. All right, here in Statesboro, we want to invite you to our Arbor Day, which is March 11th in the Edgewood neighborhood. As you know, there's a big revitalization of the Edgewood Park, and we're going to incorporate our Arbor Day and plant several trees there in Edgewood Park. Okay, now let's talk about, we talked about past, let's talk about the future. In addition to Edgewood Park, Robert's done a very good job along with the beautification committee. We also have another partnership with the local school. This year, we picked Sally Z. Last year, we worked with Maddie Lively. As you know, Sally Z was a cotton field, and so there's not a lot of trees. So in the front, we're going to plant 6 trees. We're working with the STEM class, Science and Technology. Group, we're going to plant 6. They're going to be in charge of taking care of them. But as you know, most of you are familiar with the school, in the parking lot there's a big grass strip that doesn't have any trees in it. It's about 20 foot wide, so that's going to be a good project, and Henry Clay did the design on that. All right, the second project we're working on is the commercial corridor on Brandon Street, between the medians on Brandon. It's our biggest commercial corridor, and that area is known as the area that doesn't have any trees. So we'll start at the old Carey Hilliards and go all the way to, we're going Robert, to the movie theater. Yeah, Mother Street at the movie theater. So you know, these are programs that are supported by council and mayor with the tree bank money, and we appreciate it, and we're making good use of it. And so now we'd like to call Doug Shaffero and Sean Diddy with the Georgia Forestry Commission to make a presentation to the city.
Good morning. Good morning. Proud to be here. I'm Doug Sashro. I'm the chief ranger of Bullitt County. Been with the Forestry Commission about 24 years. This is Sean D. She's the management forester for Bullitt County also. And this was always a special time. Arbor Day, I mean, that's an achievement to see, you know, City of Statesboro, the Statesboro Tree Board, and the Georgia Forestry all working together to make our, you know, beautification of our city. The trees are important. So we got the brand new Tree City USA flag just come in yesterday. Also, the new stickers, 24 years. That's a big achievement. It's not easy to be. It's not easy to be Tree City USA. It takes some doing to maintain it, but that's a big achievement.
Short of the I would like to say one more thing. I'm also, as well, not only the forester for the county, but also help on the tree board. And trees, like Doug was saying, are so important. There's so many benefits we get from trees, whether it's oxygen, they help clean the air, they are beautiful, and then also don't forget, like, paper and, you know, things like that, the mobility, like toilet paper and paper towels and pencils and even crayons. There are a lot of things that come have tree products in our parts of trees that we don't even think about. Football helmets, you know, all kinds of things. So anyway, I just wanted to mention that don't forget how, you know, all the benefits that trees give us.
Thank you. I could have gone all day without hearing the word football.
I know.
Okay, get out of that ball. Just two plays up the middle and kick a field goal. Just run twice. I mean, it's University of Georgia against Georgia Tech, 1999. Not that I'm
horrible.
Anyway, two plays up the middle. Okay, we're going to finish up our tree portion of today with a proclamation by the Mayor and City Council of Statesboro, Georgia for Arbor Day. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees. And whereas the holiday called Arbor Day was first observed with the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska, and whereas Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world, and whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our topsoil by wind and water, lower our heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature of clean air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife, and whereas trees are a renewable resource giving us paper, wood for our homes, fuel for our fires, and countless other wood products, and whereas trees in our city increase property values, enhance economic vitality of business areas, and beautify our community, and whereas trees, wherever they are planted, are a source of joy and spiritual renewal. Now, therefore, I, James J. Moore, Mayor of the City of Statesboro, do hereby proclaim February 17, 2017 is Arbor Day in the City of Statesboro, and I urge all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day and support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands, and further urge all citizens to plant care for trees to gladden the heart and promote the well-being of this and future generations. So, thank you again for all the work that you guys do.
Thank you.
Y'all want to take a picture? Employees, but you all remember last year, I think somebody had a number about how many trees Robert Sidney was to plant. It was some insane number of trees over however many years. It was thousands. I mean, our town, our landscape of our city has changed because of Robert Sidney and trees, and thank you very much. Okay, we're going to start with. Okay. Can I have Mr. Eugene Smith?
Mayor and Council, Robert Singer Street, Park Superintendent. It is a great honor today that we get to visit with Mr. Eugene Smith. Mr. Eugene came to us in roughly 1996. 95. Eugene has been working as groundskeeper in the Public Works Parks Division now for 22 years, and has been a tremendous asset over there. He's a great friend and one of the hardest workers I've ever met. This gentleman, he is really at the top of the game when it comes to groundskeeping and staying steady on the job, and is a major asset to the cities of Statesboro. With that, Eugene Smith, retiring now with 22 years of service to the city of Statesboro. Thank you.
Good morning, Madam Mayor, the City Council, and staff. I want to talk about Mr. Joe Mingle. He's a refuse collector. It's a job that he started in January of 2007. He's been here 17 years. Let me tell you about his job. His job is a job that's unique. It's supposed to be a labor job, but when I came over there 3-5 years ago, I had some ideas of changing stuff to make us more efficient. So we went to Tabitha's and called a freon situation. And when I first started, everybody said, well, Joe never learned. But you know, you never count anybody out. And Joe the top freon. Tell you another story about Joe. He's the guy to get that extra bag, and the person that's a sick, a handicapped, or old, or can't get the poly cart to the curb, he goes get it. And we had some new guys come in on the collection equipment operator, and Joe knows the whole city. So I moved Joe to one side of the city to help this guy learn to ride. So I kept getting calls, "What Joe is?" And these customers. And I said, "Ma'am," she said, "What, Joe?" He said, I want Joe back on my route. Joe know what to do. So you got an employee that dedicated to go out there and do his job to his best of his ability. So your customers start calling, requesting him to come back. Wow. I said, "Give me a couple weeks, you know, so I get this guy trained and I get him back over there." But all I can say about Joe is that he's a hard worker and a hard learner. You know, my biggest accomplishment was that he learned how to use that tablet in Freon. You know, I'm not too far behind you as far as an age, and you know, computers and tablets wasn't happening then. And he took it upon himself to learn it. And like I say, and the Freon is something that we do. We go out the day before and plot with yard waste. Everybody remember 7 years ago, everybody was complaining about yard waste. That complaint is gone. And he was one of the key figures in it because he was the eager head of it and making sure it gets done. So Joe, I haven't worked with you number 5 years, but it's been a great 5 years. And I hope you have a great retirement and whatever plans you got. I know, and you told me that if I need you, call me. You'll come back. I'll be right back. Well done, man, Joe. Yeah. Congratulations and hope you have a great retirement.
I enjoy working with the sanitation department and with a group of men. We had some good days, had some bad days. But through it all, we came together and got on one accord. But I One thing about it, I ain't left, but I'm ready to come back. So, my door is open to any one of y'all. I told Steve and Billy I'm ready to come back, because they can't wait down there without me.
Congratulations so much. We're going to stand right here and I'm going to read this out. Presented to Joseph Mingle, Refuse Collector, Public Works Department, for 17 years of outstanding and dedicated service to the City of Statesboro this February 2017.
Thank you.
You will be
welcome. Come on, good boy.
Jeffrey Grant, Director of Human Resources. Good morning, Mayor and Council. We're doing the Employee of the Quarter Award. And real quickly, the purpose of the City of Statesboro Employee of the Quarter is to recognize outstanding full-time and part-time employees of the City of Statesboro who embody the city's mission, which is to provide the most responsive and progressive public services so that our residences and businesses and visitors can enjoy the highest quality of life Statesboro has to offer. We operate City of Statesboro Employee of the Quarter, as well as City of Statesboro Employee of the Year in June. I think what I'll say this real quick, I think what's really good about this one is, you know, employees are here, and this is an opportunity to recognize employees, you know, while they're here and while they're doing really good things employed with the City of Statesboro. But this particular employee, I'm going to read it as is, is Marty McLean. He works in the Central Services IT Department, and as noted by the nominator, Marty has numerous duties that are behind the scenes in nature and gets little recognition, such as server maintenance, network maintenance, and other critical services that go largely unnoticed until they don't work. Marty often services the network at home during non-office hours, and on many occasions has come into work in the middle of the night from his home in Millen to make needed repairs. He has done this with a very positive and professional approach. During our recent hiring process to replace Paul Wheeler, who was one of our IT technicians, Marty was very involved in the hiring process and has taken Solomon, who is our new technician, our new IT employee, under his wing in an effort to fast-track Solomon's assimilation into his role with IT. This has paid great dividends for the department, as well as the City of Statesboro departments. In summary, Marty possesses a vast amount of technical knowledge and complements this knowledge with a very professional approach to his job. In a time when resources are limited, Marty is a major factor in determining the success of the IT division of Central Services. And without further ado, the employee of the quarter is Marty McLean. If you can come on up, Marty.
item four is public comments. We do have a public comment regarding an agenda item, and I would ask if Mr. Nicholas Boyles, if he is here to step forward. State your name for the record, please.
Thank you, Nicholas Boyles. Good morning, how
are
you doing?
Good morning.
All right. Hey, I have a question. I'm just curious about the combination truck on about how the decision was made. And the reason why is because I submitted a bid proposal of what I was asked. And I know that some of the things that SuperProducts offer, they don't offer the same thing. So that if it's a price thing, I mean, I submitted what I was asked, and I know it's more than what they had to offer. So I was just curious to know how the decision was made on that.
Well, we can do one or two things. I'm kind of part of Mr. Wetmore, but we will be bringing that up as agenda item 13, uh-huh. And at that point in time, we can discuss that thoroughly and address the concerns that you have.
Okay.
All right. So, I just make note of that. Unfortunately for you, it's agenda item 13. But it is on your side. But that's okay. We'll address it then, okay? She's not here to deny it, so. Sue disconnected John Riggs. So.
Thank you.
And y'all call John didn't read the minutes. Duly noted, does council have a problem with that change?
No.
Okay. Any other changes or comments regarding the minutes?
Everything else is correct.
If not, I'll ask for a motion to approve the consent agenda with change duly noted.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. Agenda item 6, second reading and consideration of a motion to adopt ordinance 2017-02. Just real quickly, review that one as Kane. If you don't mind, please.
This is the ordinance that's being proposed to make our licensure requirements at least be the minimum requirements that the Department of Revenue enforces on state licensees. Obviously, any city licensee is going to need a state license before they move forward in serving and selling alcohol beverages. So I just took the language out of the city, out of the state requirements, and either modified the existing ordinance, admit with it, and also added an additional clause on item number 4 on the proposed ordinance.
Any questions for Kay regarding this agenda? Okay. If not, do I have a motion to adopt ordinance 2017-02?
So moved.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. Agenda item 7, second reading and consideration of a motion to adopt ordinance 2017-03. Mr. Smith.
Once again, this is not about the state language on this. This is the one where council expressed concern to possibly 5-year look back whenever a licensee has an alcohol violation. It's too large of a window to look back on. The original look back was 12 months. The one we currently have is 5 years, so this was a compromise in the middle in order so to things could fall off prior to 5 years. And that anything in those 3 years could be considered on what sort of sanctions would come upon finding a violation there.
And just to be clear, 3 years was the recommendation of the advisory board?
Correct.
Did we go back to the advisory board on that? Because
I believe it says. I believe they voted too, yeah.
Yep.
We did?
Yeah.
Any further questions or comments on ordinance 2017-03? If not, I have a motion to adopt ordinance 2017-03.
So moved.
Second. Any discussion? If not, all in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. Let's move to agenda item 8, which is public hearing and first reading of amended ordinance 2017-04. I'm going to speak to this real quickly, Ben, if that's okay with you.
Of course.
Last week, or excuse me, that's not after last meeting, or weeks ago, we discussed changing the wording of the catering section of our ordinance. And going through that process and trying to be, let's see how to put this, and trying to work with citizens in our area regarding the catering, actually part of the ordinance. It came to our attention through due diligence and things, and y'all have to just understand that we have been in a transition from the city attorney that worked on this language and stuff to a new city attorney. And so whenever you have transition, you know, you gotta work through that. Kane was able to really put some time in and look at the catering ordinance as it was proposed here with the city and the catering language as it stands at the state level. As you all know, it's an effort in futility. An effort in futility if our ordinance in certain ways doesn't mirror or reflect the state ordinance, because they can get a license all day long here, but if our language isn't consistent with state language, they're not going to be able to get one in the state. So the whole it was exercise is moot. And this is one of those areas that it affects. And so we can have things that are unique to the city of Statesboro that have that aren't addressed in the state license, i.e. how we exercise the penalty phase. That will be a good, it doesn't matter. This one does. And so, in looking back at the catering thing, we don't want to give somebody a catering permit that they're not going to be able to do under their state license. It leads them in the wrong direction, and it's just not good governance. So, Kay went back and looked at all of that and said, you know what, we are all better served, and those folks that are up here trying to seek a permit are better served if our language mirrors the state language. That way they'd be able to do it in both. Get permits in both places to do that, permission or whatever. So that's what we did. We went back and looked at it and made sure that what we're passing is consistent with the state law, so that we're not leading anybody or suggesting that they can do something differently here that they wouldn't be able to do in any other part of the state, because that's not the case. I will go ahead and say that the folks that were really trying to work with that catering language, first of all, our alcohol advisory committee, work diligently, and they understand, and the folks in the private sector that were trying to use our catering language or use the catering language that suggested they understand that it was, like I said, it was almost an exercise in futility to do it the other way. So for the purposes of good governance, we're going to come back and do a first reading where our catering language, having said all of that, y'all are asleep now, to mirror the language that's in the state regulations. And so I'm going to let you comment on that, or ask you to comment on that real quick, and see if council has any questions.
What we did, what I did with ordinance here, what we did with ordinance here is, like Mayor said, it just reflects the state language. And furthermore, it gives reference to the Georgia Administrative Code and the Code of Georgia statutes that cover catered events. Because it is a fairly involved private procedure to actually have to sell alcohol beverages off premises by the drink. It's not as simple as what there are lots of measures in the state requires, such as these quantity and destination reports that have to be filed with the state, certain markings that have to be on the vehicle, the fact that all of it has to be paid before it gets, at the time it gets to the off premises location. There can't be a cash bar once you get to the location. And then they're proceeding from returning the unused bottles back to the caterer's regular inventory. There's a lot of stuff. I mean, if we wanted to, we could have added about 4 or 5 pages to the ordinance in order to put all the state regs in there. To save time and sanity, what I did was simply do a cross-reference to the state administrative code and laws, so that caterers are on notice of what the state required.
Okay, one thing I did not do is let me just ask for a motion to open up the public hearing on this so that if there's any discussion from those in the room that are able to do so. Do I have a motion to open up a public hearing on ordinance 2017-04?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. So, I'm sorry, go ahead and we can ask the public. Or is there any comment from the public on ordinance 2017-04 as a first reading?
I have a question, Mr. King. When you made the local ordinance and you said reference to state, that means that you will apply for cable license. You read the state law, they need to, give them the names and qualify for the state, and then come to the city of Clark.
What they need to do in order to get the state permit is have the city permit first. And then they sit in the application, they have, I believe it's 5 days that they have to get the state notice. They also send in where it's going, who's going to be taking it, what sort of vehicle it's going to be in, and the fact this will be, that there will be, the vehicle actually has to be numbered with the caterer's state alcohol license on either side of the vehicle. And so the first step would be to get the city permit for the catered event, and then after that, then they would get everything to the state, and the state would then approve it if everything was in order.
Thanks for that.
You're welcome.
So to be clear, if you want to get a catered event permit through our ordinance, you're going to have to abide by the language of the state ordinance to do so.
Absolutely.
That's what we're referring to.
Right. There's no reason for us to allow something and then lose their state license and they'll lose their whole local license when that happens.
Okay. So again, I'll ask, is anybody, as a public hearing, does anybody here want to speak for or against ordinance 2017-04? If not, I'll ask for a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Okay, does council want to have any further discussion regarding ordinance 2017-04? We will not be asking for a vote today, as this is a first reading. Consideration of a motion to approve resolution 017-05.
Mayor, Council, this resolution covers a $15,000 grant from to be administered by the Georgia Association of Chiefs of Police through the Governor's Office of Highway Safety. It's a non-matching grant, so it is $15,000 to the city for the purchase of mobile data terminals for our patrol cars and other equipment related to those vehicles and computers. Again, it's a non-matching grant. 100% of the funding has to be used for that purpose. The only stipulation with the city is that we enter into an agreement with a company, name is called Gears, to submit our accident reports electronically to the city. It's kind of win-win for us because DOT pays for that interface for us, and it also will cut down on staff time copying these accident reports to have them sent to DOT. So both phases of the grant are completely funded and have it before you. They were
reference, I think you said Gears would be, I guess, receiving information on going to the state.
Yes.
How do we transfer information now?
It's a staff member copies exact same reports every time, prints them out, and has them mailed to the state. So this will be completely electronic and cut down on that time of printing them. Once the accident report is completed in the system, the computer system actually sends it itself. So no staff time will be used to have to touch the accident report, so it's sent to the state.
Does that happen real time, or does somebody have to do it at the end of the day or something?
No, sir. I believe it's every 15 minutes that it actually sends an update. So if an accident report is sent, and approved, it every 15 minutes any approved reports are sent.
Are there any further questions for Chief Bryant? Any comments? If not, do I have a motion to approve resolution 2017-05?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Do I have any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
As you recall, at the beginning of our meeting, I said we're going to postpone agenda item 10, so let's move on to agenda item 11. Consideration of a motion to support city working with the DSDA. Alan, you want to
come? Alan, you come up. I'm going to talk a little bit later. While that one's coming up.
Okay.
You're going to see two exhibits. What this agenda item is really, we're asking myself and Alan are asking council to support us proceeding and moving on. Alan is the executive director of DSDA, is really working on the city's behalf, but also really the community's behalf on two projects. Exhibit one is showing where a proposed dog park would go, and I'll let him explain where that is. And then exhibit two, it's off of East Main Street, and that's really an area that we're trying to utilize for green space. So there's a couple of agreements, informal agreements, that I've made with Alan, and we'd like to make sure that y'all are okay with those as well. And they're as simple as the leases, and these are both railroad properties, so the leases would be in the city's name. DSDA would pay the annual lease itself. Any liability insurance would be on the city's, as a rider on the city's insurance. The city would provide it. Water tap, and then we would provide basic maintenance, which is trash pickup and little repairs and things like that. But we're really hoping, and Alan probably talked about this part, is that most of the capital expense will come from the public. So let you take it from there, Alan.
Okay, well, we've been working on this. I was looking at my notes. This is going on about 8 months. We're on our fourth employee from Norfolk working on this project. I think this is a testing project for all new employees.
You got six more to go.
Yeah, I only got six more to go. Thank you. So anyway, they've run out of excuses and reasons. So we've had to deal with two railroads. It's not that one was hard enough. We needed to throw another one in there. So between the short line, but again, Robert Singlin has been very helpful with the short line. They have a great working relationship. So that actually went pretty good. So anyway, we've been talking for years about a dog park. There's been a lot of interest. I get emails from time to time, hoping, wishing, asking about it. And when Habitat left that place in Exhibit 1, that opened up, they already had an existing lease on it, so we thought it would be easy just to tag along. So that's what we submitted a package. We did all the flat work and stuff, and so it's, they said maybe... I said the end of last week, but this week. So I think we're getting close to them. The Norfolk asked for a letter from the short line stating we're fine, we're happy with whatever they want to do. So we've gotten all that. So we've gotten everything they want. So hopefully, on exhibit one, we've got some money set aside already for, thanks to the chamber and those folks. They've used leadership will have raised some money for fencing. We've got, I believe we could easily get a committee together. Anytime we bring it up, we get a group of folks. So I would think that we get a lot of community involvement in building it out. Maybe hopefully no expense to anybody to do that. So that, and then the exhibit two, We're just looking over time. That area needs cleaned up. There's been some conversation about it, and we thought we'd go ahead and take a lead with it. And that part there that you see in the blue, is we're all from here. It's kind of a maintenance yard. So we wanted to lease it, clean it up, and we've worked with the Shoreline to take it down to Hill Street for their area for maintenance. So the Development Authority, Downtown Development Board, has worked and agreed to help build out a facility for them on Hill Street Railroad so they can put their gravel and ties there. We'll just, Jason Bowles and I have some ideas on cleaning that up. So they haven't signed the lease, but we are so close that if they did sign it, we've got a group that's already ready to go and start working on the dog park. So if they gave us green light, we want to go ahead and start.
And we go, right?
Yep,
that's perfect. And we would come back to y'all for the formal agreement. Obviously, Kenny would review the lease, and we've got some things in language that I'd like to see, and then we bring that to y'all before we actually sign. So really just looking for any questions, comments, and then even a vote, I would, if possible, just to show support.
Well, I know we've talked about a dog park for forever.
It's about the third location we've worked on.
And so I know folks will be appreciative of that, and I appreciate your work on diligence on trying to make that happen.
So, Robert, are you looking for a motion to just to negotiate
just
a lease?
Support,
to negotiate
yeah.
a lease?
Yeah, yeah. Based on the attachment that's in here, which is more kind of an informal agreement between us and what Alan's been doing for us with the DSCA.
So basically in support of what you're doing, and you bring the lease back for us to vote on.
Yeah, we have to vote on a specific document, right?
Right.
Yeah.
You would.
So I'll make that motion.
We have a motion to support the city work on the DSDA for a memorandum to go and negotiate leases on those two pieces of property. Bill's motion,
so
do I have a second? Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you both. And Robert. Well, I did want to mention one thing, and to thank, so that we have a representative from Dorset University in the audience today. Just to say, if y'all look at this issue of Georgia Trend, you'll see where Georgia Southern University took out a one-page ad congratulating the city of Statesboro on being named one of Georgia's three large live workplace cities. So, working together works. Thank you very much. Agenda item 12, consideration of a motion to award a five-year contract for copy printer equipment to Digital Office Equipment, Darren.
This recommendation is for a copier slash printer contract with Digital Office Equipment for a term of 5 years. The 5 year, by Georgia law, we're not really bound to 1 year at a time, but presenting the 5 years. In the write-up that I submitted to y'all's package, I tried to do a monthly, a yearly, and a five-year cost based on our past 12 months of usage to try to compare our current contract and this proposed new one. This will be based, if approved, on the Washington County Board of Ed contract. I contacted the purchasing department. They're pleased with it, and it obviously is a valid contract. And we're allowed to, if desired, to do that for our ordinance. The projected amounts also include a possible savings of replacing inkjet printers with some more cost-effective printers per copy. That's a lot of the savings that you see in those projections. Outside of that, we'd be glad to answer any questions about the content of the contract. And we do have representatives from the Digital Office here as well.
I think one of the things, just to clarify for folks, what it means by ordinance, so we can piggyback on somebody else's contract.
What that means is another entity has went through the bidding process, the competitive comparison, like we have done. They put out the bid, they voted on it by their governing body. It's
I have a copy of the contract. That's one of the things we have to get. And so the competitive element is there. We just didn't come ask to extend the current contract because we want to see the, you know, vetted out there and see if it's a good deal. From all indications, it seems to be.
Okay.
Okay.
Did you say we have a representative of digital if you want to speak?
Yes, sir. And that's a projection, you know, we use, you know, more or less copies, they'll fluctuate somewhat, but, and I would like to add is, if approved, we can extend the units or subtract from the units, so the printers and copiers, if we change our mind for the total number, so it fluctuates based on unit pricing. And when we did put this out, I asked the digital office to submit a document, so it's the exact copiers Washington County we will have here, so it's the exact cost per unit.
So the fixed part of the contract is $2,700.
Yes, ma'am.
And then above that, at the $4,997 is what's going to fluctuate based on usage, correct?
Yes, ma'am. And the fixed part, if we decide we only want 12 copiers instead of 14, then, you know, that would go down based on unit pricing. But the 27 is based on 14 copiers. For example, we'll be having under this contract 14 copiers instead of existing 13. So the numbers indicate 14 over 13.
The only thing that I'm looking at on this one is the 5-year part of it. We don't typically go out 5 years.
We have been on copiers in the past, but by Georgia State law, you might be mistaken. We're not locked in, but each current budget year, if we decide next year, no, we can get out.
It's 5 1-year agreements, right?
It's 5 1-year technically.
Yeah.
Yes.
1 year with possibility for renewals.
That's correct.
So do we come back and vote on this every year?
It's truly up to y'all.
Yeah.
As long as there's no problems, it's good. If you have a problem, we'll come back and vote on it.
I think you have to vote to give them the amount. You'd have to come back and vote for the renewal, Councilman Jones, I would think. So we just have to vote at renewal time. Since it is a 1-year contract with 4 1-year renewals, is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, at the park price. Okay, any further questions?
Any comments, Mr. King?
Not Captain Jones, this is current mayor assessment and all that.
Okay. All right, then. Do I have a motion to award a 1-year contract with 4 1-year renewals? Options for as listed in agenda item 12.
Mm-hmm.
All right, do I have any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. All right, Mr. Boyles. Patience will be served. We're at agenda item 13. Consideration of a motion to award a contract for the purchase of a combination sewer vacuum truck to Super Products LLC per contract number 02204-SPL in the amount of $332,363. And I think in your presentation, Darren, you may want to discuss how the bid was decided.
Probably.
And please use the microphone.
What's been done in the past, be it
fire vehicles, trash trucks, this type of vehicle, is we've utilized a lot of times the cooperative contracts, NJPA, the one out of Houston, Galveston. The reason being on these type of things is most heavy equipment, the specifications between vendors are all over the place for one. The through the advice probably of our maintenance division who works on longevity, certainly they're comfortable with certain brands. And so these contracts allow us to select the brands that provided successful maintenance and longevity for us. Again, for our cooperative contract ordinance, we're allowed to do that through that mechanism. There's certainly nothing wrong with bidding out the old-fashioned style. It just allows for the reason that I said. With that, we have got to answer any questions. And,
so Jason was the person that was in charge of this process?
Well, I'm sure he submitted the specs
mm-hmm.
and the contract.
Okay.
But he would probably need to secure that and he would probably need to read.
Okay.
That'd be fine.
Okay. I appreciate it.
I mean, because to me, this is a lot of money.
Sure did.
We're talking $332,000, is that right? $332,000, so. Do I have a motion from council to table this?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We'll table this to our next meeting, and Darren, I would ask you to get with Jason and maybe, is it Nicholas Boyle?
Yes.
And let's get to the bottom of that.
Sure.
Not going to promise you a change in outcome.
Hey, yeah, I know.
Right.
I just wanted to hear a change.
Darren, is that NJPA, is that similar to the like motor pool that we buy our police cars from?
It's, well, the police cars are off a state contract.
Right.
NJPA is like the Houston Galveston, it's a cooperative contract that government entities and one another.
But I mean, it's still kind of a group contract where we don't necessarily go out and bid, we just go to that
well,
designated contract.
Well, they handle it.
I got you.
We take advantage of the contracts at the moment.
Right.
Yeah.
Again, similar to the police cars, just different organization.
What's that now?
Similar to the police cars, just a different contract.
Yes.
And doesn't that group then bid several different kind of brands? So isn't they just didn't bid that one particular one?
They like this and Houston Galveston, they go out and bid based on specs, and they have the buying power of Houston Galveston, 15 counties in that area. So that's the price you make. Yes.
Where is Adams Equipment based?
Not scheduled.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Our agenda item 14 is a motion to award a contract for consulting services to complete a citywide strategic plan. Frank, where are you?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Frank Neal, Director of Planning and Development.
Today we have a consideration of motion to award a contract for consulting services to complete a citywide strategic plan to AMAC Foster Wheeler in the amount of $28,500. This will come out of our general fund budget. But this project was properly advertised for request for qualifications. We did receive a few, and AMAC came to the top, and we're requesting approval of this project. If you got any other questions, I'll be happy to answer that for you.
Why don't you talk about the process that the public will have?
Absolutely. So AMAC proposed a several planning services to prepare the delivery of a citywide strategic plan. The company will come in, they'll have four tasks to do an analysis of existing planning documents for the city of Statesboro. That includes our comp plan, our long-range transportation plan, our capital improvement plan, the DSD master plan, et cetera. They'll do a data analysis, including the preparation of an economic snapshot. They'll also do the implementation program. This will all involve a number of public meetings. Some of the actual processes include several public workshops, public hearings, and they'll facilitate the public participation. In addition, the company will recommend action items associated with each of Statesboro's planning documents, and once the tasks are completed, the company will deliver a 5-year and a 10-year implementation plan for our capital improvement projects and community-wide projects, etc.
What from a time frame? Did they give us an idea if we're able to schedule things in a timely fashion based on how they see the process going? What kind of time frame are we looking at?
We are looking at a 3 to 6 month time frame, roughly. Again, it depends on how quickly they receive the data back. And that's going to include everything from our elected officials, our city staff, and of course, the public. And I encourage, that's one thing, we can go through this process, but, participation is very important in all aspects of all those levels we just talked about. And not only the participation, but support as we go through this process, so that when we have this plan in place, that we can implement it with full support of elected officials, staff, and the city as a whole for it to be a success.
And I'll tell you, one of the things that got me, a strategic plan proponent is one of the things I brought up several months ago that I felt like as a city we didn't have, and that was, we needed that. But one of the things that brought it to the forefront actually was, to me, at least for me, and why I've been pushing it so hard, is Councilman Boyum made a comment several months ago back in the summer, or basically, no, really, it was last May. Mayor Jim, we're talking about, don't, it's good. Down there, his eyes are about that big. But anyway, no, it was about raising the water bill, $2 or $4. It was a relatively small amount to most people, but it did concern Councilman Boyum, and he questioned the water department about for what? Just because you need it? Do you not need it? What are we doing with the money? And I thought that was absolutely a legitimate request. And I think that while we may think we're making very good decisions, and I think for the most part we do, we're not going to talk about the funeral procession. But we don't have the data we need to support the decisions that we're making. And operating off gut's not a lot of fun. And so with a strategic plan, we can begin to look at what different districts need, what the city's going to need from an infrastructure standpoint over the next 5 to 10 years. It's pipes have to be fixed, roads have to be paved, assets have to be maintained, safety has to be on the forefront, all of these things. And without that strategic plan, we can't point to what we need or why we need it as we go forward. Remind everybody that SPLOST is coming up. And we need to be able to explain to our citizens why that's very important that we continue with the county to have SPLOST in place, and things are just going to have to be done. And so hopefully our citizens will get involved in this, and I want to encourage, so Al, back in the hallway when you write about this, please let us know it's not just people that live in the city, it's people that own property in the city. We have lots of property owners that do not live in the city. And it's my hope that they will be involved in this process as well. and that they will choose to use their voice, because this is going to be the guiding document regardless of who's where when that the city will follow when it makes decisions over the next several years. So that's my hope. We're going to do everything we possibly can to advertise and get people excited about. We want folks to know, to tell us what they want their city to look like in 5 years. What do you want your city to look like in 10 years? And then we'll take that collective vision and see what it's going to take to get us there. And at that point, you begin to make those decisions about what you prioritize and those kinds of things. So, you know, I encourage council, if y'all have anything that that you would like to say about that, that's my feeling on it.
I'm very excited about it. I'm very thankful you said having the data necessary to make sound decisions, not just with great hope.
Well, I think a key too is if we have these plans in place, we can take advantage of opportunities that present themselves or prepare ourselves for opportunities. And one in particular, you know, that new $5 hotel tax for transportation, all of a sudden that money is starting to pile up and they're going to start doling it out. And I know expanding 67 is very high on the regional transportation list. So when that happens, you know, we need to be, as a city, be ready to take advantage. Do we want to run water out that way? Do we want to run sewer out that way? Do we want to run gas or even help a fiber company run stuff out there? Hey, if they're digging a trench, let's use the same trench. No sense of digging a trench twice if we can dig it once. So there's a lot of opportunities like that, even getting the water and IT together to use the same project money. So I think that's really getting us to work together to share our resources is really where that plan is.
And I think you're absolutely right. I think that we've been more reactive than proactive. It's not necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes you just go through seasons in governance, and we were in one of those seasons. But I'm hoping that this council over the next several years will be a proactive council. We've got a lot of wonderful opportunity in front of us, but you've got to corral it and get your vision in place so that you can do those progressive things that 20 years from now people say, wow, City of Statesboro is pretty smart. You know, they came together and did some things that had a lot of foresight in them and were exciting. So again, I'm hoping that this plan will lay the groundwork for that. I'm hoping that our council will be excited about it, get their constituents and their district excited about it, get business owners in the city excited about it, landowners, et cetera, because this is a great opportunity to paint what we want our town to look like 10 years from now.
Absolutely.
So.
Yeah. And we've got a great legislative team right now, so it'll be a great opportunity to put this plan in place and put that in front of Jack and Jane, mm-hmm. and Butch and John, and even Governor Deal, who's going to sign it for here.
No doubt.
Take advantage of it while we can.
Absolutely. And so not to be a downer. I'm going to get down about this whole thing, but part of the plan, too, is to figure out how we pay for all those agreements.
Oh, no doubt.
And so we can figure out what it is we're going to do going forward. But
10% cut in upper management.
Okay, I'll be there. Speechless on that.
You set yourself up.
But, you know, one of the other things that we're going to have, too, is a survey. So those people that can't make those public meetings will also have that opportunity to give us their input and talk about those quality of life things that they want. I mean, it can be as simple as needing more street lights in some areas. So things like that we want them to tell us about, as well as those major projects we're going to need done too.
And one of the things that we'll bring up under other business kind of in just a second sort of talks about what you were talking about, Councilman Bourne, having an opportunity in front of you that if you have a plan in place, you're able to take advantage of that opportunity What is that old expression? Luck? It's not luck. It's the result of good preparation. So
opportunity plus preparation.
There you go. So in that case, do I have a motion to award a contract for consulting services to complete a citywide strategic plan to AMAC Foster Wheeler in the amount of $28,500?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. We move to agenda item 15, which is other business from City Council. I do have one item that I'll save for last. Does City Council have anything that they'd like to have? Under other business. Okay, this is another business item. I think in the 3+ years that I've been mayor, I think I brought maybe one item up to vote under other business. But this is an opportunity, and it just, it just presented itself to us at the end of this past week on Friday, and we vetted it out a little bit yesterday amongst staff, and so we didn't have time to put it on the agenda, but I'm going to bring it up today. And I'm going to let Robert get into the weeds of it a little bit before I ask y'all to vote in support of this, but I'm just going to kind of paint a picture. For several years, we have asked the Georgia Department of Transportation to aid us in some things around the city that we felt should be their responsibility to help us in or help us with. And I will say this, that Robert and the engineering department have been very diligent in requesting help in some areas, and have met with DOT regional office and et cetera over years, just hoping, we get a little something, get a little love down here on a couple of projects. Well, it just so happens that somebody caught somebody's ear in the last few days, and there may be an opportunity for us to get some, what I would call, we hope to be significant funding for a couple of projects in Statesboro. To do that, however, we have to have a little skin in the game, too. And it's kind of like when we talk about CDBG money. You know, they're going to give X, but for us to get X, we got to give Y. We're not quite sure what Y is yet, but this is what I would like to ask council to do for us to send a letter once Robert explains, and we'll get down to it. The ask is going to be to send a letter saying that we're really willing to commit a certain percentage of overall funding towards these projects. So at this point, Robert, I'm going to stop and let you sort of talk about it. I mean, the basis is DOT is willing to give X. I don't know what X is yet. They're going to let us know. If we're willing to give 30% of that as a match. So we're trying to go through and figure out the things that we're currently doing that would count as a match, that they would recognize as matching funds, and we can discuss it after that. So go ahead.
Right, the 30% comes from, that's a typical GDOT formula that they utilize when they give grants, although probably the way I like to write the letter is not being that what we're talking about are improvements to South Main. I don't want them to say, well, here's your amount, and they just do a little math and say, here's our amount, because that being a federal route with a state route coming into it, I would like them to really step forward and do some, even go beyond that formula, that typical formula. But as a starting point, we need to show what we've committed to it. And fortunately, in our CIP, really what y'all are going to end up doing here when you vote is just reconfirming a couple little items that I'll say here that had some vagueness to it, and I'd like to commit these dollars toward this potential of this project. I'm just going to go through these real quick. We've already spent $46,500 of the ABC contest money. Went toward engineering preliminary design, and that was at UNC Engineering, so that was a commitment that's already spent. DSDA committed $15,000 toward that same, toward improvements, toward things on River and South, South Main, so that's another $15,000. In our CIP, we have a project, WWD-147, which is a tier one project set up for FY 2018, which was for water sewer improvements on South Main Street, and that's $350,000. Now, whether or not GDOT will utilize that in the formula, probably not, but I think it's important that that's real dollars to us. So I think it's important that we note that. And then these last three are all come under our CIP, either through what we term geometric improvements or roadway improvements. And we put, really, not a lot of money, but we put money in there as much as we can, because these are SPLOST funded. We put money in there, for example, if there's an impact from a school or a border settlement or something that's been, if we did prepare for some radius improvements, then we got some dollars in there. And I would recommend that we take three of those entities and take $50,000 from each one of those, so a total of $150,000 to go toward putting in the letter and submitting to GDOT. So you've got $150,000 and $350,000 and $15,465,000. So
close to $600,000.
Yeah, $550,000 to $600,000 that you show on a commitment letter to GDOT going for South Main improvements. And what I like, and we argued with the letter to the district office back in September, and that was for drainage improvements. Because we all know there's a section of South Main that literally has no drainage structures. So we've asked them to do that, and they've written us back saying that they've committed to studying that. They're already, they've already hired an engineer who's worked on the plans and come up with the cost estimates for that. And then a larger project, which has been on our radar since 94, when we did a study, so over 20 years, was for the Fair Road 301 intersection. And we've heard lots of ideas through the years, and that was our one of our number one. Came out of a public meeting, came out of a study, strategic plan, and I think I said that the other day. One of them where we had like 30 projects, and we've literally done 25, 26, 27 of them, but that number one one has always been that one. And I think that's one of them that we need to push hard as a part of this South Main improvement, fix that intersection. That's why I say that, let's just say they took into account 600,000. I don't know that when they do their formula, I don't know that the rest of it's going to be enough to improve that intersection and do the drainage and maybe do some other things that we'd like to see them do. Makes sense what I was saying?
Right, so to be clear, when we send a letter saying thank you very much, and we'll be happy to give what we can, we're not sure exactly what they're willing to give, so we don't know what the end number's going to be. And, you know, at that point, I've decided we really can. You know, if it's above and beyond, we're already putting into things. Are we going to specify in the letter that we would like the drainage issue fixed and to focus on the intersection? Was that those are the two projects that we've had in the works for a period of time?
That'd be my opinion.
Okay. Because they do, my understanding is they want us to try to at least qualify some projects. And those two are things that they are familiar with that we've talked to them about for a number of years. Not the drainage as much as that whole intersection situation there. Okay. Do I have a motion to authorize Robert to, and Randy, excuse me, come up with a letter that says that we will certainly accept with gratitude any funding and to please consider the following projects as going towards our contribution, our matching contribution. Now, obviously, if they come back and say, here's $10 million, that's not fine. And so, therefore, you need to come up with three. We're going to have to come back in here and figure out how we would do that. That, you know, the city's not prepared to do that, but we have to be prepared to say we're open to anything you're willing to give.
What if they came back and said we got three, you got one?
We'll have to figure it out.
Even that would take
some
finagling, but okay, so that still leaves the door open for that. So, we really have no idea where DOT is as far as the number?
No.
It could be 500,000, it could be 3 million.
Yeah,
million.
That's why I don't want to.
Yeah, you don't want to throw a number at it. It's like negotiating a salary. What do you want to give me? What do you want to make? What do you want to give me? What do you want to make?
Well, we don't want to negotiate against ourselves.
So
I'm just excited that they're looking at our community and you're willing to give us that support. So we'll just have to see what it is.
Who do we need to send through?
I think it's supposed to be one that award. I just want to send that. So if that's okay, do I have a motion to authorize the city of Statesboro to issue a letter to the Georgia Department of Transportation saying we're willing to participate in the gift that they potentially are willing to give us?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. And again, I apologize for the short notice, but this came up Friday.
And
just
a thank you to Robert and Alan. I know that DOT and the railroads, I mean, if you think city government is move slow, those guys move really slow. So I appreciate you guys' patience because it's months of negotiation to even get to this point. So appreciate your work.
That's all I have.
All right.
probably be ready to show us the website. This was a carryover from the last meeting that went a little long, and the website's been up since
January 1st,
and so here's a little.
I must say, I'm really, sure. Really proud of this website. I was on the beautification committee. They pulled it up, and I was like, eh, you might need one tweak out of it.
I know,
about to see your email.
Oh, no, ma'am. Before we get started, I'd really like to thank the committee that worked on this, Sergeant Jake Sachs and Sergeant Patrick Lim, Officer Mary Harris, and Officer Tara Lewis. They put in the work to get this to where it was at, and our partnership with Stuart Gregory at Capstone. Stuart and his team were able to really get this to a point that we all feel really good about, and hopefully it is something that the community will find very user-friendly. One of the things we looked at was our former website was not user-friendly. There was not a lot of information at your fingertips. The design of this has made it where this is interactive and easy to get information to, and there's a lot of information that a citizen can now get simply by going to the website. Since the website's been up for a month, there have already been 4,630 page views in this month and 7 days. One of the big things that we want to get on there was our crime map, so that citizens could be able to easily access and see what was going on in town. This is the main page itself. You can go to the crime map at the top or through this icon, but it immediately takes you into a map of the city. That's slow internet connection.
Where's where's our employee of the quarter? Get up here.
This feature, as it is still loading, allows you to see the different crimes throughout Statesboro and allow you to filter. First off, it's you go to anything within the last week, you'll filter down to a larger number, where if you go to the last 6 months, obviously a much higher number. And it's also going to remove a lot, because you would see nothing but a covered map at that rate. But within the last week, you can draw dial down into that or either 3 days, and then zoom into particular areas and actually see what's going on. And it's an area that you've got multiple offenses at. If you'll hover over, it'll tell you what it is to quality of life issues. Just any of the other things on there, you'll be able to draw down into and see what's going on and be able to make some decisions. We get a lot of phone calls, especially over, during the summer, from parents that are wanting to know information about, well, should my student move into this particular location? Well, we try not to refer to a particular location and give a recommendation. What we can do now is refer them to a tool so they can make the best educated decision themselves. So we find that is a very great tool. A lot of other things are available through here. Online reporting for certain offenses. If you've got an offense that meets the list here, criminal trespass, identity fraud, suspicious activity, or theft by taking with no suspect information, you can now go online and submit a report without having to have an officer meet with you. If it's 4 in the morning and you just prefer to be there at your home by yourself, you can submit that report online. We'll also be launching a kiosk within the next 2 weeks, I hope, at the police department for people that do not have computer access. They will be able to access all of this from that computer in the lobby.
One thing we talked about too, Rob and I did with Stuart, showed officials from George Southern University this site and how students could take advantage of it, why it would be a good thing for them. One of the things that came out of that meeting was putting a kiosk in Russell Union. So if they wanted to report this stolen cell phone, or they wanted to report this, they can do it right there at Russell Union without, or go online, either way. But we're trying to become more engaged, because that's a fairly substantial population within our city. Another thing on there was, you can put in there, watch my house when I'm gone. You can do that online now. So you can notify, you know, our police department, the police crews by and check that. That's another thing students can use. Don't live within the city to check, but, you know, we can talk about forwarding those reports on. Paying a ticket, that's not obviously the best thing in the whole world, but it's there. But those are the kinds of things. And another thing, too, which I thought was really important, was, and I hope people pick up on this, you can give a tip this way, and we talked about with apartments and students out at George Southern, that, you know, if you suspect suspicious activity in your apartment complex, you can give an anonymous tip. And it truly, Rob, you may want to comment on this, there's no way to go back and figure out who gave that.
No, through tips off, the server is actually in Canada. The reason for the server to be in Canada is no U.S. subpoena can pierce that international law there. So we don't know who it is. That's why it is set up that way, with that server being in another country. It protects the data. Several other things, but including the tips, including being able to pull your accident report up yourself if you're involved in an accident or either an incident. You can come in, pull the accident or incident report up by adding just a little bit of information there, and print your accident report at your home. You no longer have to come by the lobby to pick it up. You can also do an incident report the same way. There's a list of everyone, as far as a warrant list, people with outstanding warrants. Through the Contact Us feature, and Councilman Riggs, I don't know if you remember your request, but we are working on this one. Back when we were talking about submitting complaints on different things, and I think what you asked for, tow trucks, there is a way right here for anyone to come under, and we're getting a drop-down built, so if it's a towing-related complaint, and in talks with the mayor, when we meet with the students, since they are primarily who's affected the most, be able to put that information out to them and make them aware that it is there. So it's been a culmination of a lot of those things. We have a community calendar. It's being populated now. Reported is a free service through Leads Online that lets you store information on your valuables, such as their serial numbers or replacement costs. Really helpful if you're the victim and we can get a serial number, we can try to get your property back. It's just a way, it's free of charge for the citizens to be able to use. And one of the things that I'm very proud of is of what they've done in the recruitment area, getting information in here for recruiting purposes, not only the video, but even outlining the benefits the city has, going through the full benefits packages. They took a lot of time here, even talking about disqualifiers, and there were tips to be a successful candidate. So I believe the web committee that worked on this put a lot of effort into it. There was a lot of outside consultation, and I do appreciate the mayor coming, because I believe you and Mr. Randy probably met with us four or five times throughout getting this thing together, but it's finally rolled out, and I'm very proud of what our team was able to do.
I think one of the things we all face, and I think it was reflected in an article that came out in the newspaper this past week about, you know, everybody being short-staffed and what we can do with what we have, including, you know, George Southern's us. I mean, everybody. That's just law enforcement. I was on a chair task force in Atlanta on municipal hiring, career kind of stuff. Anyway, everybody's in the same boat with being short-staffed in public safety. And I know that we receive, I think people are shocked, I'm always shocked when I hear this number. How many calls a year does the Statesboro Police Department get?
Don't have this year's total, but I'm saying 65 to 75 and upwards of 80,000.
That's thousands. In a year, 80,000 calls. And it can be the most serious thing down to, I lost my cell phone. You know, I mean, so anything we can do to automate some of those things that are not life-threatening type of calls and emergencies, to let our folks who are working at the police department spend their time on those things that you know, really are protecting our citizens. Our safety issues, we're all better served by that. So it's my hope that as this website becomes more usable, people recognize that it's there and all the things that they can do with it, that we'll see at least the call volume drop some. And I don't think people have any clue, or at least I don't. It amazes me every single time I hear that statistic, that 75,000 calls in a year.
And Mayor, one of the things that we are doing is trying to draw into that data now that we have the new reporting system to be able to better tell what type of calls, what is typically been logged as a call in years before that may have been something that is self-initiated, so that when we get into releasing the annual report this year, I think we'll have some of the best data that we've ever had.
And maybe that data will provide things that will lead you toward additional automation of things that you do, because we haven't been able to do that in the past. So, I thank you very much. That was a lot of hard work. How long did that take to get that put together?
If I remember correctly, Robert, we started talking about March or April as far as the concept of doing it, and it took until January 1st to launch it. We're hoping it would be a 4 or 5 month project, but it... we wanted to incorporate as much as we can. Getting that crime map in there was a major undertaking to actually get it to function without having to have the citizen log in through 2 or 3 different things. We had it at one point, and Mayor, if you don't mind, the mayor's like, I want you to make it easy for everybody. So we went back and Capstone was able to capture that and do it. And I appreciate what they were able to do there, because people are only going to use it if it's easy and at their fingertips.
That's right. I'm going to tell you a funny story. They're actually doing some work on a section of our website of Geechee Technical College that I'm over that part of the division that it applies to. So we were looking at the schemata of it to make sure that the schemata was what we wanted before they infilled all the data. And on one of the menu bars, it came up and said crime map. I was just like, what are you doing? And I said, we know how much you love the crime map. So, we just I said, well, I mean, this is on a Geechee Tech website, you take crime map off. They thought that was kind of funny. They said, we think you can't live without your crime map. So, there you go. Anyway, thank you. And do keep us informed about changes and updates.
Yeah.
I think, you know, one day, the City of Statesboro website might look this good. We've talked about that.
Thank you.
We're still talking about it. Well, action comes soon. So now we're to Cindy, and she will talk about something that was approved in the budget, the credit card user fee. We're getting close to actually implementing.
Good morning, Cindy West, Finance Director. Yes, if you recall that we did budget in the 2017 budget to start assessing a 2% convenience fee for credit card users. We're at the point where we are ready to implement that beginning March 1st. We will be putting the notification on our website. We will put it in the utility bills as well as the signs downstairs to let our customers know that we will be starting that on March 1st.
Okay.
I just want to make sure everybody knew that was coming and they weren't surprised when they started.
Anything else? That's it. All right, in that case, has anybody asked to make a public comment?
No, ma'am.
Look at the way you pulled that microphone right over there and just did it. All right. In that case, I need to have a motion, and I'm going to ask everybody to kind of scoot out here because we're running a little bit long. But do I have a motion to enter into executive session to discuss potential litigation?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.